Sainthood is not a privilege of few, but a vocation for all, says Pope Francis. Saint Ignatius says, if she and he can become a saint, why can't I? From May 2021 till July 2022, the Society of Jesus celebrates an Ignatian year. What is an Ignatian year? May 20th, 2021 marks the 500th anniversary of Saint Ignatius' conversion. That fateful day when Ignatius the soldier, struck by a cannonball, began his transformation into Ignatius the pilgrim. Inigo Lopez de Oñaz y Loyola, whom we know as Saint Ignatius, was born in the castle Loyola in the Basque country of northeastern Spain in 1491, during the reign of King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. Inigo was the youngest of 13 children, raised in a family culture of high Catholic piety but lax morals. He experienced the contradictions between the ideals of church and crown and the realities of his own family. Inigo hardly knew his mother, Marina Sáenz de Lincona y Baldamaría. She died when he was a child. His father, Don Beltrán Yáñez de Oñaz y Loyola, died when he was 16. One of his brothers went on the second voyage of Columbus and another died in battle. Inigo was raised to be a courtier and diplomat in service to the crown, having received a chivalric yet academically sparse education, typical of his class of those times. The cannonball that hit 22-year-old Inigo de Loyola and ended his career as a soldier was not a direct hit. On May 20, 1521, Inigo had rallied the Spanish troops at the Battle of Pamplona to continue to defend their citadel rather than accept harsh terms of surrender by the French, Navarre's forces besieging them. Then a cannonball flew over the bulwark. A fragment of the wall hit by the cannonball flew off and injured Inigo's left leg, and the cannonball itself shattered his right leg. At his family castle in Loyola, Ignatius went through painful surgeries, a long recuperation, and a total conversion of heart and soul. Eventually, he renounced his worldly goods, laid down his sword before a statue of Our Lady of Montserrat, changed his name to Ignatius, went through torturous confessions and bouts of scruples, traveled to the Holy Land, was sent away from the Holy Land, and eventually became a highly sought-after spiritual master. Ignatius drew to himself a small group of men who would form the core of what would become the Society of Jesus, better known today as the Jesuits. They were formed in the image not only of Christ, but also of a man whose bravery and charisma on the battlefield was simply rechanneled to a fight for souls. He recorded his experiences in a notebook and would soon find his jottings helpful in guiding others. These notes, which he continued to revise and expand over time as he listened to people, became his spiritual exercises. Eventually, they were published and then reprinted again and again and translated into many languages as they spread around the world. Although Ignatius was unable to preach and serve God in the Holy Land as he had hoped, he was still determined to meet this goal in some fashion. He decided that he needed to get an education in order to help souls. He returned to Barcelona and attended a free public grammar school to prepare himself for entrance into a university. Education was a need for a Jesuit then and has been a priority even now. This meant that at the age of 33, he was studying Latin grammar and other basics with classmates who were 8 years to 14 years old. He may have felt some discomfort at the age difference, but it was at this time that he had the most beloved teacher in his entire academic career, Master Jerónimo Ardevol. Eventually, he earned a master's degree. The name on his diploma was not Inigo but Ignatius, which he adopted in Paris and used for the rest of his life. While at the University of Paris, Ignatius roamed with Peter Faber, a young man from Savoy in the south of France, and Francis Xavier, a nobleman from the eastern end of the Basque country. Gradually, a whole circle of friends in the Lord, as they called themselves, formed around Ignatius. Ignatius's words from the Holy Bible: "What does it profit if you win the whole world and lose one soul?" changed the life of his friend Saint Francis Xavier. Their decision was to form themselves into a religious order. They called it the Company, meaning the companionship or society of Jesus. Outsiders nicknamed them the Jesuits, but the name caught on and eventually was used by all alike. The Society of Jesus was approved by Pope Paul III in 1540 and thus became an official Catholic religious order. Ignatius was elected their first leader, and he accepted the position and served until his death 16 years later. As the superior general, he sent companions all over Europe and around the world. He told them to hurry to any part of the world where the needs of the neighbor should summon them. In addition to writing the constitutions of the fledgling order with the help of his assistant Juan Polanco, he wrote nearly 7,000 letters. He wrote to many people within church and state and to women as well as men. But most of these letters were to his Jesuit companions, thus forming a vast communication network of friendship, love and care. At the time of his death, there were 1,000 Jesuits, a good number of them involved in the 35 schools that had been founded. 25 years later, the number of schools rose to 144, and another 35 years later after that, it approached 400. Today, there are 16,000 and more Jesuits serving in 122 countries across the world. As we are in the 500th jubilee year of the conversion of Saint Ignatius and 400th anniversary of his canonization, let us remember that all the setbacks in life is an occasion to bounce back to life. And education is a need of every person. It can be achieved at any time. The Jesuits for the last 500 years have done so much for the world, especially for the poor. And let us meaningfully say the prayer which Saint Ignatius repeated often. Let the prayer of Saint Ignatius be ours. Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we are doing your will.